filming?
This will, the whole thing you will have. But not without the commentary, unless Karuna gives it to you.
Yeah,
I'm going
to.
Which she says she's going to.
Yeah, she hasn't recorded.
But I've posted this online.
It's something is happening to me now. I have projects for the future.
Oh, yeah?
And the book that I told you, I put on the back burner. This picture could be used if I can.
Oh, absolutely.
Because it's the ancient way of talking, of saying so many things, but within.
Remember, the culture that this arose in was an illiterate culture.
Yes.
So everything was in pictures.
Yes. Maybe I didn't write it because I didn't see this picture. I was looking for something like this.
That's how early Buddhism was taught. Oh, it was taught in pictures and stories. It was not taught scientifically.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Well. In 2004, I received a degree in Ayurveda, and the very first thing I got when I came into the class, on the very first day of the welcoming class, the head of the whole school arrived, and he was a social misfit, which I didn't know at that time, and he says, everything in the world, without exception, is medicinal. And then he said, everything in the world, without exception, is poisonous. And then he said, Ayurveda will teach you to tell the difference between the two. In this presentation on Ayurveda and aging, we're going to explore these various differences. And after I graduated from college, I went to Benares. I've been in not poor as like Kansas. I mean, they have some really good Sanskrit scholars there, but here's like Kansas. But Benares is not Roman. Benares is the oldest still living city in the world. And in Benares, all the great saints of ancient India, at one time or another, almost without exception, went to Benares. Has anybody heard of Kabir?
Yes.
Kabir was a great poet, saint, recognized by the Hindus, the Muslims, and the Sikhs. In fact, in the Sikh Guru Granth, their holy book, they have tons of stuff by Kabir. Kabir was a very, very, he reminded me of Michelle. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's you.
Who, me?
People would come to Benares to bathe in the Ganges there. It's on the Ganges River. And Kabir, an enlightened, incredible saint, wonder worker, miracle worker. This is, in the 1500s. Kabir said, if bathing in the Ganges brought salvation, which was the typical thought, you bathe in the Ganges, you get saved. If bathing in the Ganges brought salvation, then every fish is in heaven. This was a taste of Kabir. The king of Benares had built his palace on the opposite side of the Ganges from the city of Benares. It was a big palace. And he wanted Kabir, who was so famous, as a Hindu king. He wanted Kabir to come visit my palace, see what I've done here. He was very proud of it. And this is a picture of it.
What century is this?
Century of the 16th century. And he said to Kabir, okay, you got that. What do you think? And Kabir said, there's two defects about this palace which cannot be remedied. And the king was like, what are you talking about? I got money, beyond, and I have more than money, men will do it, whatever it is, I'll fix it, tell me what it is. And Kabir said, this cannot be fixed. And what is it? He said, one, is that this palace, this palace will grow old and decay. And the second is that you will grow old and die. So, and the palace has grown old. Our consideration is suggested by Kabir's grow old and die, which brings us to Ayurveda and aging. So let's begin with the consideration of Ayurveda, which we've done. Ayurveda is the Veda, or science of life, Ayu. It's taught on earth so mankind can enjoy a long and healthy lifespan. Ayurveda contains the vidya, or knowledge, of how to create or maintain the health of the healthy and cure or palliate the disease of the diseased person. Palliate means to make better. In other words, there are some things that cannot be cured. They can only be made better. And I'm giving away a lot here. Aging is one. See, there's two things that cannot be remedied. You're going to grow old and die. So, from the Yoga Sutras, Ayurveda draws a fundamental principle. It's in the Yoga Sutras, Patanjali Yoga Sutras. It goes, Hayam Dukam Anagatam. The dukkha, suffering, that has not yet come, anagatam, can be avoided. In other words, you can't do anything about the suffering that's here because it has karmic reasons. But if you change your actions, if you gain the knowledge, and you follow and you do things that will change it, then much suffering that has not yet come can be avoided. Ayurveda says with proper understanding, we can move towards health by means of right action. There's a causative factor for the manifestation of bodily needs. The man and woman make love, the sperm are attracted to the egg, there's insemination. So there's a cause for the manifestation of a bodily being. But there is no cause for the cessation, since death following birth is of the natural order. It is natural to grow old and die. It is not something that can be avoided. Suffering born of time or aging is inherent in life and cannot be avoided, but only palliated, made better. In other words, you don't have to die sick. You can die healthy, but you will die. You will die. This is a foundational principle of Ayurveda and aging. So let's look at time. Life is held in the hands of time. You saw that. Time is a fundamental consideration when we consider aging. So we saw this picture. See the guys in the upper right and the upper left-hand corners? Mm-hmm. You always see this in the wheel of life. Those are Buddhas. In other words, there is a principle, there is a teaching, there is a wisdom that lies outside the wheel of life and color. There's an eternal teaching. And that's where, why the Buddhas, why the great teachers, there's a ton of teachers in the world, of all qualities, there's very, very few, in my opinion, of great teachers, very, very few.
Both of those were Buddhas?
Excuse me?
Both of those figures were Buddhas?
Oh yeah, and, like, have you ever seen this? Anybody ever seen this? You see something very, very, very similar to this on every single Buddhist monastery in Tibet, made for an illiterate culture. I told you, Buddha drew it out when the king was looking for a gift to give back to this kingdom, giving him just this incredible gift, since they were his. And Buddha drew this out. This is Kala. See with the five elements, five crowns. Same, you see the wheel of the Dharma up in the upper left-hand corner, and Buddhas, and there's many Buddhas, teaching Ayurveda, old age and aging. Aging is a disease brought about by time. It is written in the Ayurvedic text, Shiryate iti sharira. The body is constantly decaying. We know everyone who has taken birth must grow old and die, but no one wants to grow old, no one wants to die. But even from conception, well, some people, okay, some, but even from conception, the body is tending towards death. According to the Buddha, birth, disease, old age, and death make up the inevitable suffering of a human being. Buddha was asked, how are you different than other beings? And Buddha said, I was bothered by old age, disease, and death. Other people didn't seem so bothered. He was like, he took all Vedic culture, he was Hindu. He took them just like Jesus was Jewish. Buddha took the whole Vedic culture and said, look, it's not about worship of gods or bhakti, or not that there's anything wrong with that. He's not criticizing. But he's basically was saying, you have to go beyond old age, disease, and death. That's what it's all about, and that's what he taught. He kind of took the essence of the Vedic culture, and that's what he taught. Just like Jesus, the essence of Judaism. This is not about the letter of the law, God's facility, the book of life, and all this, but the Torah. He says it's about something else. It's about spirit, whatever the heck that is. So Buddha said birth is suffering, old age is suffering, illness is suffering, union with unpleasant things is suffering, separation from pleasant things is suffering, like whenever I'm away from you. Not obtaining what we wish is suffering. And all clinging to existence is suffering. I just told you about this. In Ayurveda, any condition that is not pleasurable is called disease. In Tibetan medicine, which came out of Ayurveda, Indian medicine. By the way, Chinese medicine, Tibetan medicine, Unani medicine, and through Unani or Persian medicine, Greek medicine, Galen, and Hippocrates, all came out of Ayurveda. They were all about the humors. They were all about, well, everything is medicinal, everything is poisonous. It depends, and it depends on the humors. Or the doshas. So Ayurveda considers aging born of time as natural. And only palliative disease. Palliative means a treatment that affirms life and regards aging and death as a natural, normal process. It reminds me of hospice. Hospice care is palliative. It provides relief from unnecessary pain or distress and symptoms. And even though Buddha said suffering is inevitable, he also said that all suffering is not necessary.
All suffering is not necessary?
In other words, suffering is inevitable, but all suffering is not necessary. That's a really important thing often left out when you hear Buddhists talk about that. You know that life is suffering. Yeah, Buddha did say that. And he also said, but all suffering is not necessary. Buddha had an Ayurvedic physician given to him by the king of his day, King Bimbisara, who was named Jivakara and was known as the greatest Ayurvedic physician of his day. And that was what the king had given to Buddha in gratitude for all that he had advice. So the disease of aging is inevitable, but it may be manifested in a timely or untimely, comfortable or uncomfortable, disease-free or disease-filled manner. The Ayurvedic approach to aging is to remedy or palliate the underlying imbalances brought about by aging. Even though time or kala creates an unavoidable imbalance in the body, which it will, you don't see 90-year-olds running the marathon. But Ayurveda teaches us how to palliate, make better, those unavoidable imbalances. According to Ayurveda, the growth, development, maintenance, and decay of the body, this is really interesting, are dependent on four factors or qualities. Kala, time, swaha, swaha self, and swaha, somebody who possesses their self. Swaha, kala, time, and self nature, or dosha, pinna. Ahar, diet, and paryavarana, the environmental factors. The first two, is kala and svabha, and those you cannot change. Time and your dosha, your self nature, you cannot change. That's the first two. The second two, is this helpful to have this?
Yeah.
I think you're getting close.
Well, why don't you say we just forget the whole thing? It's easy. Okay. Let me get out of this. We saw that. I went to the wrong, somehow it skipped to another presentation. All suffering is not necessary. Okay. And aging can be manifested in a benign or unbenign state. The Ayurvedic approach to aging is to palliate or remedy the underlying imbalances brought about by aging. And those imbalances can be grouped or collected under the heading of vata. Okay. And this is true for any and every type. Aging is an increase of health. Even though time or kala creates unavoidable balance, Ayurveda teaches us how to avoid or palliate those unavoidable imbalances. We talked about the four qualities. The first two, kala and svabha, we can't change. But the second two, ahara, diet, and your environment, we can change. So we're kind of stuck with time, how old we are, and with our nature or doshic makeup. But we can, the remedy, the approach to palliating is through diet and environment. That's why I'm telling everybody to move to honey. So the first two we cannot control. The second two we can. And Ayurveda provides the wisdom of how to do that. So, color or time holds a human being in its grasp from birth to death. Isn't that so fundamental of color or time that an image of time holding the wheel of life is painted directly next to the main entrance of every single Buddhist monastery in Tibet and Ladakh. This is another image from there. And you always see these Buddhas up in the, above or outside the wheel. And again, the five elements of the five skulls.
And why are there the two Buddhas in those two corners?
Such that there is a teaching, an eternal teaching that lies outside the teaching, the grasp of time. And that is the what they call the Buddha Dharma. In other words, it's not a new teaching. It's an eternal teaching that's revealed by the Buddhas as they incarnate in age after age. And so they lie outside. See, you know, what we're doing here is inside the real time, how we make it better. Like the great dharmas of Krishna, you know, in the Gita, or the great dharmas of Ayurveda are eternal. They're applied within your own time, but they're always existing. Ayurveda was not created. Ayurveda is what they call anadi, it's uncreated. It was cognized by the rishis, and then it wasn't even written down, it was recited. So these are different. This is a very, very, very common. At the wheel, at the center of the wheel, this is what you see in the center of the wheel. You see a pig holding the tail of a snake, holding the tail of a rooster, holding the tail of a pig. This is at the very hub of the wheel of life. Greed, anger, desire. And right here, right outside in the first circle around this center, you see people descending into the hell realm and then they're descended from heaven. And then they come out of hell from the Lord of heaven. And that wheel just turns. Because even good karmas that you do are exhausted eventually. And so people fall, so to speak, fall from heaven.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
How do you make fall into a bad karma?
Well, as the wheel of life shows it. So you see, this whole end of the, so what people through their good karmas rise up to the heavenly worlds, where they start enjoying, and then they exhaust their credit card, and then they rise again. Is that good? So, Yeah. Lives, not just in this world.
Right, the reincarnation.
Yeah, people reincarnated in many worlds. So the snake represents anger. The pig represents ignorance, illusion, will eat anything, lies in shit. And greed is food.
So which one is desire?
Which one
represents desire?
All of them.
Yeah.
There's a dullness to desire in the pig. There's a rajasic quality, rajas or pitta, sort of, in the rooster. And there's this anger is also pitta. And what drives the wheel is the winds. Well, really, everything. All three doshas circulate the wheel, cause the wheel. That's why I always found it fascinating once I realized what was in the very center of the wheel. In other words, everything. You know, you can't help in this world being ignorant. You can't help getting angry. You can't help, you know, wanting more than what you need, which is how they define greed. And those are called the three poisons. That's the hub of the wheel. That's everything else manifests around that. And that's why the teaching of the Buddha is not, you know, be better, incredibly nice, although it does say stuff like that. But you have to transcend, you have to go beyond. You have to get off the wheel of life, or recognize that you are always already on the wheel of life. And there's no cure inside the wheel. It's called the Bahama Chakra wheel, wheel of becoming, wheel of life. It's Kala, or time, that creates the yugas. Has everybody heard of the yugas? No? Yugas are vast expanses of time. And in the yugas, you heard of the Kali Yuga?
That's what we're in now, aren't we?
We're in the Kali Yuga. If you took this as the grand center of the universe, and then you have our galaxy spinning around the elliptical arc. Okay, we're furthest away from the grand center of the universe, that's called the Kali Yuga. And when it comes closest to the grand center of the universe, that's the Satya Yuga, the time of purity, the time of mankind, nature, everything is in its maximum benign state. But that's how that occurs.
How long have we been in the Kali Yuga?
Long enough.
Long enough to suffer.
So Kala creates the yugas, the seasons of a year, the hours and the day and night, the seasons of a person's life, and aging. Buddha spoke of time, Kala, as the context of inescapable suffering. For it's time that determines our inability to gain any permanent happiness in life. I'm going to tell you a story. You just told me if you should tell this. There's a story, it's a true story in the Buddhist tradition. It's short, very short. A woman burying her dead child came into the company of Buddha. Does anybody know this story? The story of Kasinathama. She thinks that he's sitting in the forest somewhere and his disciples are around him. And she comes in crying herself with her dead child in her arms. And she goes right up to the Buddha. This is a true story in the Pali Canon. And she says, Buddhaji, you're known as a great, great being. Can you bring my child back to life? And Buddha sits for a moment and then he says, bring me some mustard seed. Mustard seed is like salt in America. Everybody's got mustard seed. Mm-hmm. Buddha says, bring me some mustard seed from a house in which no one has died. Mm-hmm. She's off with her child. He goes back into the village. He goes to the next house. Mother, call each other mother. Do you have any mustard seed? Of course, my child. Can you get it for me? Of course, my child. Brings him some mustard seed. She puts it in her hand. Has anybody ever died in this? Oh yes, a month ago, my father died. I cannot take the mustard seed. And she goes to the next house, and the next house. And in every house, it's the same story. Everybody has the mustard seed, and everybody has had someone die. And so she takes her child, cremates it. She comes back to the Buddha and she joins the Buddha's Sangha community around him. And it's called Cure the Mustard Seed. That unless this is felt deeply, time is the context of inescapable suffering. Karma is the context of inescapable suffering. One really has not much use in the Buddha teaching. I mean, of course, it can be helpful. Doing things the right way, being kind can be helpful. But in terms of enlightenment, in terms of what Kisigatami, how it changed your life. So it is time that it determines our inability to gain any permanent happiness in life, no matter what our actions are. And just as we need to understand the place where we live, the season of the year, the time of day. For instance, the Jews go down to Florida. Why? Because it's warm. They don't want to spend winter Michigan or, you know, Maine or New York, even. They don't want to spend winter there. They want to go where it's warm.
Right.
So it's helpful. It's balancing for a person in their Vanta years to be in a place where it's helpful for a person in their Vanta years to be in a place where it's warm. Not necessarily hot. The Jews get warm better and look good. So Ayurveda says it's necessary to understand the season or time of our life, as well as the season of the year and the time of day. The effect of time on the body is kshaya. Kshaya means drying, diminishing, with all the capabilities of the body and the mind of old age. Let's look more closely at how kala or time is expressed in the stages of life. The Upanishad, Chandogya Upanishad, says that a man or a woman should enjoy 116 years of life.
So, how long ago is that Upanishad?
More than I can. That would be around 4,000 years ago.
You said you could live to be 116.
They didn't have oxo back then. They didn't have, you know, it was a really good diet. Good living conditions. What people died from back then were, they certainly had diseases here and there, but not as commonly. When we looked at those pictures of all those different cultures, the cultures that ate very little and very, they didn't die of malnutrition or disease. They just died of, like, you know, worm infection or some kind of thing like that nature. So Banavasta, Bala's youth, to 24 years, Yuvavasta, 24 to 68, and Vrivasta, 108 to 160. These are the three stages of life.
The average is between 68 and 108.
I'll forget it.
For lunch?
Thanks. Lunch. Everybody went out for lunch. Thank you for that. I appreciate that. I'm correct. So 68 to 160. From conception to a girl's first period, approximately 14 to 16 years, although now it's happening even earlier, which means that people are aging more quickly. It's the time that kapha or earth and sing in boys. It's clearly marked in girls. The kapha or earth and water element rules appear in kapha. Steady increase and coordination of the strength and integrity of the body, mind, and senses. Then middle age, adivasa. The fire element, pitta, hormones, start to appear. And it goes to around 60 to 70 years of life. Y'all correct that. It is dominated by pitta dosha, an increase of hormonal activity, the digestive abilities of food and experience are at the maximum. Full engagement in the senses, mind, intellect, and a greater or lesser mastery of will, depends on how you were educated. And Vritavastra, old age, from 70 years to our death, there's ever-increasing wasting, decay, kshaya, in the body. And this period of life corresponds to Vata dosha. And as I pointed out before, there's only one person in this room all jealous. So, see, you're not in your Vata years. You're in your Pitta years. As we age, there's a natural decrease of the dhatus, sort of the bodily tissues. There's wrinkling of the skin, graying of the hair, baldness, especially in Pittas. You know why? Because the elemental fire burns the roots of the hair. So this is like a classic sign. I was offered an Ayurveda coach. Several of the doctors said, you should use what was it called, bringeraj, this particular herb, and rub it on your hair and go back. I didn't care. It just didn't matter. So I never tried. Wrinkling of the skin, hair, baldness, diminished ability to do physical work, diminished digestive power, the jatara agni, the digestion of food, diminishes, and also diminished immunity. That's why old people have been so careful with COVID. The immune system is no longer at its peak. In old age, even if one is not sick or in pain, there's a decrease in the sensory organs. There's a diminishment of strength, speech, mental and cognitive functions, memory. I can remember scriptures, but I can't remember people's names. That's an excuse I'm speaking to it. And a decrease in intellect and analytic ability. It doesn't mean a person becomes stupid.
I think what I always say is like you got so much in your files, you start to need it.
When these symptoms come about in accord with a balanced or a healthy svabha, self-nature, dosha, it's known as natural aging. When aging results from a defective diet and lifestyle, vritavastra, it means earlier people die earlier, people age, show signs of age earlier. And then it's known akalaja, vritavastra, untimely aging, and is usually accompanied by disease. I like this picture because it shows a guy smoking a cigarette, looking worried, anxious, and all those three go together. If you start any one of them, they often lead to the others. Aging can be slowed, and untimely aging is preventable. Even if the symptoms of untimely aging are already manifested, they can be managed or palliated by applying the principles of Ayurveda. Like increases like, opposites decrease one another. The word for health in Ayurveda is swastha, as in swastika, same word. Or sama, as in samadhi. Sama means balance. And balance is the working principle and goal of Ayurveda. According to Ayurveda, the pathophysiology of the sickness of aging is caused primarily by diet. And the process of aging can be slowed down by correcting and balancing the diet and lifestyle. Svabhava, self-nature. So the first factor is time or kala. Second is svabhava. So, the svabhava, time applies to all beings, and all beings are branded with a dosha that is inescapable from birth. That is your prakriti. When you see me for an Ayurveda consultation, I am mainly addressing your vikriti, not your prakriti. Because we are dealing with what has become imbalance, moving in the direction of what your original birth is. But that's what we're dealing with, vikriti. For most people in the West today who gain little knowledge of Ayurveda, the elemental makeup of the body is called svabhava, which is another name for dosha. To balance svabhava, it is necessary to understand the five elements, as each of our bodies is composed of differing combinations of what are called the five elements. And Michelle, is it okay? With Michelle, when she came to see me this morning, I said, we're not gonna go into dosha. It's happened before, but not with anybody here. Why? Because, and this is a good example for people here. Because Michelle is what they call full of Alma. Does anybody know what Alma is? And that although she has inflammatory conditions, the arthritis or something like that, it's rooted right here. And unless we reduce that, because what's going on is there's a heck of a lot of fermentation, which is what happens when shit stays in one place for a long time. That is at the root of the arthritis. We're not dealing with, I acknowledge high pitta, but we're not dealing with pitta dosha. We're dealing with illumination, okay? Usually with old age, this is untimely aging.
This is what,
the
kind of aging?
Usually if a healthy person enters into old age, then we have to deal with vata dosha. If an unhealthy person enters into old age, we have to first deal with that unhealthiness. Is it, you know, a lack of nutrition or overabundance or lack of digestive fire? So this, your case is a little bit different, which can help you understand the principle.
Can I ask a question? Do you think there was a lack of digestive fire, or is it, or am I doing well, as well as I do, because I do have decent digestive fire, I just have too much ama?
Well, it's sort of both. You astoundingly have a good digestive fire under these circumstances, just in general. And, you would be in a much worse state. But it's like you've been given $1 million, and but you just went out and bought a car for $250,000, you know, and then you're thinking of buying a yacht, you know, for another. You're running out of money. And so it's time not to address the dosha, but rather elimination.
Because a lot of times when I'm traveling, like with a group, I'll be one of the few people who doesn't get sick.
There could be a lot. You, like I said, your tongue and your ability to hold up as well as you have, which is not a healthy condition.
Right.
Is amazing.
You said it's in her gut. Is that specific to her, or that's specific to
a
age group, or
dosha? No, this is unhealthy akalaya, pretty much. Unhealthy age. She's about to enter into her older years with a condition that, under the influence of vata, will get much worse, much quicker. Okay? It's okay.
Yeah.
So she's like, you know, tremors is about to go into the nervous system. It's not that bad yet. She's got arthritis. It's not that bad yet. But it's not that bad yet. So this is a unique position. Somebody would have this a genetic inheritance that was good. Screwed. That's the technique.
Screwed it up.
I screwed it up?
Yeah, you did. Unless you thought you could be free. There are exceptions to understanding. This was a really good example, I thought, for this class, you see. It's not all dosha. I told Michelle, we'll address dosha once she, and this is just basically a whole bunch of shit. And it's fermenting. And that fermentation is creating arthritis, the high pitta. And so there's not some doshic food that she should eat more of. It's something she just has to eliminate. That's the first thing. Thank you. we must understand the term of dosha so we can balance it. And when we understand our environment in terms of the five elements, we can understand the doshic effect of the environment. Like me, I did not understand the doshic effect of sleeping under air conditioning, which I thought was just the coolest thing. You don't have, you know, and I just slept under it, and I woke up with a really sore neck and horse. And I suggested that they tell people how to come from different environments. So the five elements are ether, akash, air, vayu, fire, tejas, or agni, but not agni. I don't want to use agni. There is a fire of digestion called agni, which is completely different than the fire of pitta. So that's a whole consideration. So we're going to use the word tejas. Water, jala, and earth, bhumi, five elements. And there you see. They're called the pancha. Pancha means five. Maha means great. Bhutas means elements. All the earliest medical systems of the world were these things. All of them. Because you're not just looking at your body, you're looking at everything in creation, food, climate, time of day, time of life, in terms of the elements. It's an incredibly revelatory consideration. When the Panchamahabhutas are considered in terms of location, they're called the environment. The desert, the ocean, the forest, the mountain, the cold, hot, windy, dry. Vata, cold is not good for vata, which usually down in Miami. The Canadians come down to Ahik every winter. Big bunch of foods can't take the cold. They're older. Vata is cold. They don't want more cold. Windy, vata's air, even don't want more wind. So when it's considered, the Mahabhutas, when you consider them in terms of the environment, you get the different locations. When they're considered in terms of food, the six tastes, sweet, sour, salty, bitter, pungent, astringent, those are the six tastes. Has anybody seen a tali? Do you know what a tali is? A tali is like everybody serves tali. Basically, they know an Indian food restaurant. You know, they'll have like a metal plate, they'll have a big bunch of rice in the center, and then they'll have six small cups around the outside. Mm-hmm. See that? Those six small cups are sweet, sour, salty, bitter, pungent, astringent. That's lost in the Indian culture for the most part now.
They just put whatever they have.
But see, it was so one mother could make a meal for the whole family. And then the kapha boy could trade the pitta, his pungent stuff, vice versa.
What is it called? What is the plate called?
Tali, T-H-A-L-I. I think I have a picture of it.
Yeah, the Buddha was saying that when you satiate all six of these
tastes,
you don't have cravings. Yeah.
True.
Yeah.
True.
You're satisfied. And they say that the brain functions better then.
Yeah.
Because there's nothing to see.
Spices are incredibly sophisticated in India. It's not just about taste. See, we think of spices like ooh, taste. They think of spices in terms of the master chefs in India. They think of spices in terms of healing, balancing, you know, a person. Like they're spicing differently in the winter than in the summer. They're spicing differently in Kerala than they are in North India. But that's becoming increasingly lost, even to the Indian people.
Yeah.
Because the Western thing is like, oh, that tastes good.
I'm so sick of everything being Americanized and generalized.
And on top of it all, dosha types are attractive exactly to the things they should have. That's one of the things always to keep in mind. Question, your own attractions. But that's the number one thing I've learned is that Ayurveda practitioner.
Any, like, what's, why is that? What's the root cause of that?
It's called prajnana prarabha. It means the senses become perverted. And the example I give, often, a woman's been in a relationship with a guy who beats her, was very abusive, for 6 years. And finally, in the seventh year, you know, that's enough, and she leaves him. And then she spends a couple years, you know, in a relationship, recovering, and she goes out to a party, and she gets attracted to another guy, and he's attracted to her. And it turns into the same kind of relationship. This has happened so many times. Mm-hmm. That's prajnana prarabha.
That's
the senses become perverted.
Wow.
And you become attracted exactly to the, not generally, exactly. Kaphas, when they tend to indulge, meat, cheese, heavy, you know, that's when it's the worst for them. Vatas, when they tend to indulge, raw foods, you know, sprouts, you know, really, like, which is the worst for them. You know, and pittas, you know, all the spicy stuff and more, and alcohol. It's, each type is attracted exactly to the things they should have. That's how I did my magic trick in my early years of practicing Ayurveda in San Francisco. I'd go in people's houses because I didn't have an office. And I said, can I look in your cabinets and can I look in your refrigerator? Sure. And I'd do that and I'd look at them and I'd say, this is what's going on with this problem. And they go, how do you know that?
What is it called? Prava?
Pragyan. P-R-A-G-Y-A-N. Aparad. A-P-A-R-A-T-H-A. You don't pronounce the A. It's not aparad. Aparad.
And there's no way to get rid of our pragya prat. We just have to work with it.
Well, no. That's
no, we can. But then we create a habit. It's like we know, you know, I stuck my finger in the fire and it burned. And then I did it again and I got burned. Do it maybe 3 times, but maybe
I mean, everybody's born with it.
It's a tendency. That's right. That's why often in Tibetan art, you'll see people being led around by a ring through their noses. Demons are leading them around. And the, you know, the pig and the snake and the rooster, driven by their own nature. Everything has its own. But everybody does not have to identify with it to the point of being led by it. That's why there's wisdom tradition, the Buddha's outside the teachings of Ayurveda.
So how do the senses become perverted? Is it something like the environment or what you're taught or?
No, it's like a good example is a woman being attracted to another guy.
So you have a problem and you don't address it, you don't fix it.
You don't recognize it as a problem.
Oh, okay.
When the senses are perverted, the mind can't think properly. People start to crave exactly what is an alcoholic, great example. You know, what do you want? More alcohol. Mm-hmm.
Is that related to something like the five horses, the seven horses?
Yeah, the five horses and the senses, yes. In other words, is there when the ahamkara, the I am, what we translate, and Sanskrit words translated as ego, when the horses, the five senses, are leading the driver's not in control. That's right.
So when you're talking about what pittas are attracted to, and then you describe what kaphas are attracted to, that's what I've eaten. Is it because I've been eating the wrong doshas foods through my life that I ended up with this?
Yes. See, this is, yes, you've been eating the wrong foods. And whatever you've been eating, you've not digested. That's why I said it is about, for you, an increase of agni, the digestive body. A lot of, I said we had lived in the Himalayas for 10 years, 12 years. And when you put wood on the fire, if the fire is low and you put a big log on it, it won't burn, right? But if you put kindling in first and then a little bit bigger and then the fire is roaring, then you put a big log on it, it'll burn.
So the mung dal for me is
super easy to digest.
Yeah.
It is the single easiest to digest food in the world.
Well, part of the reason I'm asking is, and you know, God willing, as they say in our, you know, I'll talk to you about what to eat, but you know, it's like, you know, I don't want to put another log in the fire and kill it once
right.
I get healthier.
So you're going to be on Kitchen, you're going to be on Yundal.
Not the rest of my life.
I said.
No, so I, you know, I'm getting ahead of myself, but that's part of why I want to know how I got to where I got was, you know, you said, you know, I mean, it was only when I was old. I mean, I grew up in the Midwest. I didn't eat spicy food. I ate, like, you know, meat and potatoes and lots of potatoes and, you know, cheese.
The story of the Buddhist tradition. And a man was shot by an arrow. And the doctor comes. Buddha tells this story. This is in the Vatican. And the doctor comes. And the guy says, wait, before you do anything, I need to know who shot him. I need to know what kind of bow he is. I need to know what kind of arrow it is. I need to know who trained him. And the Buddha said, such a person will never be healed.
Such a person will never,
never be healed.
You know, the doctor said,
he said, stop asking, you're telling me, stop asking this complicated question.
Well, the doctor said, pull out the arrow.
Right.
So the man can come begin to heal. Questions about what exactly, I mean, we could go into that right now, but not relevant. So the Panchamahabhutas, the five elements, are considered in terms of the seasons. There's spring, summer, fall, and winter. When they're considered in terms of the time of day, they're called dawn, morning, afternoon, evening, nighttime. When they're considered in terms of the seasons of a person's life, their childhood, adolescence, old age, middle age, and old age. When they're considered in terms of ages of the universe, that they are the grand center of the universe. They're called yugas, Kali Yuga, Dwarpa Yuga, Sat Yuga, Chaya Yuga. And when the Panchamahabhutas are considered in terms of the human body, they're called the doshas. So the Panchamahabhutas are everywhere. And the way to deal with them is opposites decrease one another. Similars increase one another. When Ayurveda traveled to the west through Persia, the Persians, big culture that way, and then Greece, these doshas were called the humors. Hippocrates based his whole medical system on the humors. He's famous for saying, let thy food be thy medicine. But his diagnostic and his treatment was based on analyzing the humors. The five
elements.
The doshas.
Okay.
And they were called differently. But that's what they, the Greeks did not include as one of the five elements, ether. Okay. They only had four because they, you know, they probably argued about it, so it's not really an element. But they took it into account as air, it was like air slash. This was the ancient medical system that came to the West. Hippocrates, all doctors, they don't do it anymore, used to take the Hippocratic Oath. First, do no harm.
Right. And then you find when you call, is it a hypocrite?
No, that's good. No, that's
okay.
H-Y.
Oh, okay.
This is H-I.
Oh, okay.
As in hippo.
Okay.
Galen. Galen was the Western guy who brought humors into Western Europe. The doshas. Okay, neither in theory or in fact is there a physical manifestation that cannot be accounted for by the concept of the tri-dosha. So, is Michelle a proof that that's not true? No, because all the doshas are messed up. Okay. But it is what you need. So the nature or quality of one's own body is called a dosha or svava, or self-being. When we consider a person, the element that predominates for them is called their dosha. The fire element predominates. Earth and water predominates, we've got a kapha. If the air and ether predominates, we've got a vata. Dosha also means that which vitiates, aggravates, darkens, or spoils, or causes things to decay. There are varying combinations of the five elements that determine the dosha. Vata, pitta, and kapha, the three doshas. So let's look at some examples of dosha and how differing combinations of the elements determine different types of human body mind. Okay. Kapha. Recognize anybody there? This is who I always wanted to be. I did. I love the fullness of their bodies. I mean, I just think it's Greek God. But anyway, Oprah Winfrey is a really good example of a very healthy kapha. Her skin is shining. The kaphas always have very thick hair, or a lot of hair. She has full breasts. That's another sign of kapha in a woman. What do you call this?
The hourglass.
Hourglass figure. She hates, she doesn't like her body. She wants to be thinner all the time. It's never going to happen for her unless she wants to eat really stringent and heavy foods. And then she can lose her hair. And this guy, that's his name, Luciano Pavarotti, died over in coffins, big consumers. Again, that's that picture of me when I was working out. This is, she's a tennis player.
Serena Williams?
No. No, it's her sister.
Oh. It's her sister.
I don't know.
But it's her sister. But this is like a black people proportionally relevant to their population are more kapha than white. They have more of that ancient genetics. Most people work more kapha than old times. Because we live in an environment that's full of vata. Moving cars, Wi-Fi, TV, everything, refrigeration, everything is quick, fast, vata. Kapha is cold, wet, and stable. Kapha people tend to have a big, strong structure, great fertility, endurance. They have rich, moist skin and hair, large, soft, attractive eyes, good long-term memory. Kaphas are known for their memory, but they are slow to learn. Kaphas are slow to learn and very slow to forget. Kaphas are slow. Kaphas, that's kaphas. What was I talking about? I was talking about kapha. Kaphas are slow to learn and very slow to forget. But vatas are very quick to learn and very quick to forget. They just like, oh yeah, I got that. But then they forgot. So it's really good. I left this out of the presentation because I had too much stuff. But it's really good in relationships for a vata to be with the kapha and vice versa. Because they balance each other, opposites decrease one another. So it's really good. And one of the things that they do, Jyotish or Vedic astrology, for couples, the parents do it for their kids. Kids haven't even met.
What is it called?
Jyotish. J-Y-O-T-I-S-H. Don't pronounce it. So, they're looking for that kind of combination. Differences. Kaphas like regularity, they can miss meals without losing energy. Don't try that with a kiddo. They don't like to exercise, and yet they're the right people that benefit the most from it. And they accumulate weight and they accumulate wealth. They're accumulators, just like their body. In imbalance, they get stuck. They tend with slow digestion, weight problems, fluid retention, lung and head congestion. I talked about how most of the people I saw going into the hospital in New York City were coughing during the COVID thing, because they're weak in the lungs. They have big chest, but they're weak in the lungs. Lung and head congestion, colds and asthma. That's why with kids, kids are in their coughing years, you know, runny nose and all that stuff. That's cough hour. And that's why in the cough hours, people often expectorate, you know, early in the morning. Their stickiness can tend towards jealousy, possessiveness, inability to change, and deep depression. It's cough. Remember Othello? Othello, the Shakespeare play. Othello was in cough. And Iago, the guy who tormented him, yeah, ultimately was killed. But he was a cough. So you can also have people of opposite types taking advantage of each other. So kapha, balance kapha, plenty of exercise, avoid heavy foods, keep out, vary your routine, avoid dairy foods, avoid any cold foods. Kapha and vata are cold, only pitta is hot. So both kapha and vata should avoid anything cold. Avoid, for kapha, fatty or oily foods, eat light, dry. Pitta, fire and water beloved. Meryl Streep, Mel Gibson. Sting, and what's her name?
She's
Nicole Kidman. Pitta, medium breasted, medium body. You know, same with Sting. Pitta predominant people tend to be average in size, with a reddish, yellowish, or flesh appearance. They have medium-sized eyes, kaphas have very large eyes, with a focused gaze. Their mental expressions are passion, intelligence, drive, ambition. They love to learn. Pitta people are cheerful, organized, they're the managers, entrepreneurs, and life of the heart. When in balance, they tend towards irritability, anger, impatience, and loose stools. Whenever you have loose balance, you're talking about pitta. Inflammations, canker sores, ulcers, I'm going to add herpes, is when I stop my pitta aggravating foods and went away. Not to return. Canker sores, ulcers, skin problems, vision problems. What's her name with the skin? Tall girl.
Marion.
This is, you know, I told her, well, outside of lead poisoning or cadmium poisoning, which I don't know about. Irregardless, even of that, it's pitta. It's red, it's inflamed, it's bleeding, it's on the skin. Pitta rules the skin. We have really good skin. Skin, like what's going on with you, this is pitta coming out, or excess pitta coming out on the skin. That's
what
I have
coming out.
Oh, just the rosiness? You have like a low-grade redness that's all over your face.
I did go out for something.
No, I saw it the first time.
Oh, okay. All right.
So is all my itchiness the pitta thing?
Pitta and vata. Itchiness is vata.
Okay.
But it's on the skin, which is where you don't know. It's pitta
vata.
But again, with you.
I know.
Graying or thinning hair. Pitta. To balance pitta, avoid excess heat. Don't come to Punta, Mita. Avoid excess oil. Avoid excessive steam. Limit the salt intake. Eat only non spicy, non pungent. Non-fermented foods. Fermented foods aggravate. You have an ongoing fermentation.
Ongoing what?
Fermentation.
Okay.
Drink cooling liquids. Aloe vera is excellent. Cooling which we like mint tea as opposed to ginger tea. Okay, ginger tea is aggravates Pitta, especially the ginger and the amount they're using here.
Yeah, it's
very strong. And for a Pitta, in this climate, for a Pitta person, that Pitta tea is like exactly wrong.
I had it the first day and I was not used to the humidity and that ginger tea, and I did start itching and feeling some skin stuff going on.
See, because Vata is extremely sensitive to everything. To everything. And so you'll feel it, other people will feel it the week after, at least in that. So, exercise during the cooling part of the day, which around here means you're going to walk up a couple more. Vata, okay, now we're going to. That was my roommate in Ayurveda College. This is all you had heard, and this is a model. You are one of the classic, not everyone, but one of the classic symptoms that you see again and again and again in Mita is constipation. She died from complications from it. She will. This is an extreme Mita person. They're like a leaf in the wind. It's very difficult for them. And they're usually eating exactly the wrong foods. Can be changed.
So chips are the worst for Mata?
Anything, okay, so you take the qualities.
Yeah, airy.
Dry, hard, rough, light, granola. You know, that's who you see coming in. But when I see Matas, it's funny, but it's always true, almost always true. That they'll come in with a big bag of supplements.
Of what?
Supplements.
Oh, okay.
Medical, you know, this vitamin, that vitamin, this, that, the other thing. They have a huge bag of it and bring it to the consultation. They don't need so much subtle things. You know, the condiment, you know, powder is dry, it's, you know, to be dry off. That's the last thing they need usually. What they need is grounding foods, fatty foods, you know. Ayurveda is not vegetarian, but the only type that is advised to eat meat on occasion, never at night, only at noon, and only certain kinds of meat is fine. So if you want to eat meat, be more into Mata than your
side. Well, the Mata over here doesn't want to eat meat, so I don't know what's going on. We're addicted to
you do not have a Mata body. She has a Mata body. See how there's a thickness. I remember seeing your arms yesterday. You have, and I'm not saying it's not a disturbance of the force.
Yeah.
I'm just saying it's not Mata by body type. So. This is a Vata by body type. This is a Vata by body type. These were two actors that were in, I forget what to do.
Yeah, that's Timothy Chalamet. That is her name. So that's.
But especially her, this is a very, very Vata person. I believe he is. But in other words, even when he grows up, he will be very Vata. So what are the qualities? Vata is cold, dry, irregular. Vata predominant people are usually thin, lean, slight build, fine features, prominent joints, coarse, dry hair and skin, small, dark, restless eyes. They're active, creative, enthusiastic, talkative. They learn quickly, they forget quickly. They're the artists, dancers, idealists, spiritual, and sensitive healers. Again, none of these types are good or bad. They can go either way or all. When imbalanced, they tend towards wind, excessive wind, air, constipation, dry skin, cramping, bloating, gas. It doesn't say that. But bloating, things like that. Bone problems, the bones are ruled by Vata. Dry, hard, rough. When osteoporosis happens, that's Vata going into the bones. And in a sense, it doesn't say, hey, let's go into the bones. That's what's happening. And instead of the bone is always breaking down and being rebuilt. That's normal. What happens when Vata increases in old age? There's more breaking down and rebuilding. And that's what we mean by Vata working into the bones. And insomnia, Vatas are famous for insomnia. So to balance Vata, keep warm, keep calm. Avoid raw foods.
Were your parents Vatas?
No, my mother was like a Pitta Kapha, and my father was more Vata Pitta. But he was super active. He was canoeing, hiking, rock climbing, walking, all this. Oh, Pitta's amazing. So, balancing Vata, keep warm, keep calm, avoid raw foods, avoid cold foods, avoid extreme temperatures. This is an extreme temperature too. Eat warm foods and spices that are conducive. This is really big. Vatas benefit tremendously by spices, right? Proper spices. Keep a regular routine. Regular, as opposed to regularity, is the great hitching pole for Vatas. They need regularity. They do things irregularly. It just doesn't matter. They need regularity.
Peter, can I ask you, really warm climate like this, and having a room temperature salad with heating elements in it and spices, can you do that on occasion?
Sure,
I'm so
but of all the people, yes, of all the people, so you would be, it would be least beneficial for you because of your high altitude.
Even the little greens that they might put around the.
And that, even that's what they need. But
I was saying I'm craving cold drinks.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I have a craving for heroin.
Well, I mean, it's just, it's exuberated from being here, being like out and doing activities and sweating. I'm just like, the warm water's not doing it for me.
I gotcha. So. I'm just saying that that's why this climate is not for you. Mm-hmm. Because it drives you to do things that are not beneficial. There's, like, this is completely the wrong climate. I mean, I got this hoarseness by sleeping under air conditioning. I'm not used to it. I'm sure there's a way to acclimatize yourself, but I would not live in this climate. Not because it's bad. I mean, probably certain months of the year would be really good. But this is an imbalancing climate because of the excessive. When you have excessive heat and you're older, for some people, if they were kaphas all their life, it's fine. But if you were a pitta moving down the floor and you're getting older and there's excessive heat, what happens is the heat, extreme heat, creates its own wind, just like a big fire. And so things can spin out. And then, he's the kapha and he's the vata, right?
Yeah.
So look at Mike Tyson's notice, you know, this is like a kapha. I mean, that guy is just, he was like super kapha. And what's his name? Crocodile Dundee. This is who this guy was. But super vata. You know, very, very vata. And the whole character he played in the movie was also extremely vata. He was very quick. I just like this picture. So there you get kapha. I should change this. And it's not just the bigger body structure, which it is. The bones are bigger on kapha. The bones are more medium in pitta. The bones are more smaller in vata. Vatas are refined. Pittas can be refined if you're well educated. And then kaphas. What would I call them? They're the great enjoyers of life. They're made for compassion, for love, a healthy couple. They're just, they can be really beautiful people, or they can be really greedy, jealous, possessive. That's very fun. Okay. Nataloka tatapindala. as is the whole world, so is the body. This is referring to hours of the day. Kapha hours are 6 to 10. That is why if somebody was kapha, I would tell them, you get up before 6. Do not sleep into your kapha hours, because you'll feel dull all day. Why? Because it's sleeping dullness in kapha hours is just too much. It's like having a pitta live in Punta, Mita in the heat of summer. Pitta during the midday hours, along with this awakening of pitta from 10 to 2, it is the best time to have your biggest meal, because the agni, the digestive fire, is also at its maximum there. When people do intermittent fasting and they skip lunch, and that's terrible. If you're going to skip a meal, skip lunch. I'm sorry.
Breakfast.
If you're going to skip a meal, skip dinner.
Dinner
is the meal to skip, not lunch, because the digestion, the whole body is key to benefit during your time. A little bit in a good amount in breakfast, but not in the evening. The agni, the digestive fire, is very low. So you want to do, if you're doing intermittent fasting, miss dinner. Don't miss lunch.
So these are the best hours to eat for these people, or?
Oh, no. I'm just talking about doshas. Kapha is predominant. I gave an example of sleep. Kapha sleep.
Right.
Kaphas tend to sleep late. It's the worst thing for them. Okay.
Oh, because that's their prime time, 6 to 10?
So you have a time that is full of kapha. Mm-hmm. And then you have a kapha person being very inert, immobile, kapha-like in that time. It just accentuates it.
Okay.
Imbalances. Pitta. Pittas tend to go to sleep very late. And when you're going to sleep, there is a woman, her name is Mildred, not a lot of people know this because it doesn't exist, but there's a woman whose name is Mildred that comes to your liver every night and knocks on the door of your life and says, "Hi, I'm Mildred, I'm here to clean your liver with me, Pitta organ." And pittas are, you know, like partying or even doing something else. And they say, "I'm busy. You know, come back later." And that's when pittas pollute themselves by not purifying themselves regularly during the evening hours, 10 to 2. Mildred works from 10 to 2. She doesn't work at other, I mean, she's always working, but that's her best time.
So not to sleep at that time for pitta?
Oh, good question, which I didn't answer. Thank you.
Yeah.
No, that is that pitta should be asleep. Because, you know, otherwise, Mildred is like, you're partying and drinking and you're dancing.
From 10 to 2 p.m.?
Yeah, 10 to 2 a.m.
Oh.
These times are true. Sorry, it is a poorly done chart. It's 6 to 10 a.m. kapha. And 6 to 10 p.m. In the evening.
Okay.
Pitta, 10 to 2 a.m. p.m.
Okay.
And then 10 to 2 p.m. And Mata, 2 to 6 morning, 2 to 6 evening.
So
Vata
should get up before 6 a.m.? 2 and 6.
Yes, it's good. That period of life, that period of time, is particularly beneficial to all doshas. It goes beyond dosha. It's called the Navaswam. It's the wind that awakens souls that sweeps around the world. Thanks, Christine. It's a very, very auspicious time.
Witching hour?
It's better than that. It's the enchanting opening to, it's not a word, but benignity, things that are benign. The mind is clear, the heaviness of kapha is gone, the disturbance of pitta is gone, vata is away. That's It's a really good time. Famous knowledge traditions for meditating.
And what time is this?
At 4, if you pay attention, there's a slight breeze. Right around 4, it varies a little. But right around 4 a.m., there's a slight breeze, and that's the lava swamp that sweeps around the world at that time. That's the best time to be awake for all doshas. But that also, especially for Vata, they gotta be going early. Okay? Otherwise, don't do that. Because it would be very harmful for Vata to not get them sleep. Okay, so is this baby Kapha, Vata, or Pitta? Whatever it is, this time of life is Kapha. And you can see how the time of life, it almost doesn't matter. Is this Kapha baby? You know, fat, swollen, juicy tenderness that you just want to eat. Diseases of a Kapha type mainly happen in their Kapha season of life when they're young. And their symptoms express most powerfully during the Kapha hours. When people get their symptoms, when their arthritis hurts, what hour? Is it any time? Is it in the morning time? Is it in the evening time? By determining the hour and or the season when these things happen, can tell you a lot about the dosha quality that's apparent.
We were at the Kapha Pitta Vata times.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we saw the Kapha, the little baby. Now we're looking at Pitta. Okay, midday hours, adolescence, midlife. You know, this picture, more or less, everybody's like right in their Pitta years. And middle-aged people are primarily affected by Pitta disorders. That's when you see them getting ulcers and, you know, all this stuff. When it's Pitta-related, heightened during the Pitta time of life. See, that's why everybody is so concerned about old age and health insurance. Because Vata, more diseases are brought, any disease has a Vata. Well, almost every disease has a Vata component. Vata is the only dosha with legs. So most in the charts of Mita, which is like maybe around this much, like 5/8, a little bit more, is all Vata. It's all about Vata. So middle-aged people primarily affected by Pitta. And Pitta disorders heighten during the Pitta hours of the day and Pitta years of the life. This is a woman I took a picture of in Mars. I was in the cremation class, and really old people would come to Benares and take up residence in these completely furnitureless hotel rooms overlooking the cremation grounds because they want to die in Benares. And the promise, the mythological promise, is that they will be liberated by Shiva if they die in Benares. So they never leave the city and they just live there. They're called Banarama. Banaras, and so I took this picture of her. I know I asked her, I said, is it okay with me? Yeah, so I took a picture, she quickly, give me money, which I did. Elderly people are primarily affected by Vata disorders, and these symptoms often heighten during the Vata hours of the day. and the Vata years of life. The five elements or Panchamahabhutas express themselves in every aspect of life. And that is the beauty of the Ayurvedic system, is that it's not just a science, medical science, it's a science of life. What they call, everybody heard of feng shui? That came out of Vastu in India. That's where it came from. And Vastu is all about how to doshically orient your life architecturally, relevant to east, west, north, south, ocean, mountain, river. That it's all about. I mean, that's what you're taking into consideration. And on that consideration is based where you should live, how your house faces, what you see when you come into the house. Like this view out to the ocean when you first enter in here is extremely auspicious. That was how houses were originally designed in ancient India, so you see through them.
Vastu,
V-A-S-T-U? Vastu, V-A-S-T-U. That's the root of feng shui.
Peter, do you think that you can, you know, change or affect the course of your aging without suffering if you live in a Vastu house?
Oh, yeah. Anything can be moderated, certainly. Paley. You live in a bad Vastu. What you should do, what I would do, if I'm to get a Vastu practitioner's famous, you know, not just like, you know, like Jews and all that stuff, but famous for good work, because there's a whole bunch of people out there, is educated traditionally, not like, you know, they went to a course here in America or something, and have them come to your house. Because the remedial aspect of Vastu is known by those kind of people. I know very little of that. But it's related to Ayurveda.
Yes.
Color, windows, sunlight, path of the sun, all that's taken into account. Just like you do when you do an Ayurveda consultation. I need to know all sorts of things about a person. Because everything plays a part. The five elements of the Panchamahabhutas express themselves in every aspect of life. Under the controlling effect of time, each stage of life expresses differing Panchamahabhutas or doshas. Now we have the background to consider aging. For aging, an old age is the time of Vata. So you can go now. Old age, the time of life. Like air and ether. By the way, I know you're taking pictures of this. I just want you to know that every one of these slides, no commentary, but every one of these slides is on my website. It's all the way on the right under more. You just look at Ayurveda and Aging. And it's there, and you'll have a much better picture. And it's made like a book. You scroll through and it's a flip book. So that's really nice. And it's got videos.
So even though I'm not in my Vata years,
I don't have to rub it.
So even though I'm not in my Vata years, my dosha is Vata, predominantly Vata.
This is from the pulse.
Well, even the quizzes that I've taken and stuff too. So.
What did I tell you this morning? See, a person can be, it's very easy for Pitta to go over Vata, but in terms of Prakriti, you are Pitta Vata. In terms of Vikruti, what's going on now, you're Vata Pitta. So, a lot of what we're going to be doing is, in terms of remedies and things like that, is remedying excess Vata. So don't confuse your Prakriti with your Vata.
Could it be possible possible for someone to be completely tridoshic or a period of life where they're totally tridoshic?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think I experienced that for a while. Absolutely. But health for that person will always revert back to what they were born. I mean, unless there's some real disturbance in birth.
It'll always revert back to
where
they were.
I
didn't hear what you said, sorry.
Oh, health, the direction. I didn't want to confuse people, so I said, I'm not dealing with property, which you're born with. But it's in my mind that this person is born with. And health always orients themselves, orients them back to what they were born with. Okay. In that reorientation, Tridoshan. Dr. Ladd thought I was Tridoshan. I told him there was no way. He said I had all sorts of teeth removed and, you know, right? And that's what he told me.
You were born Tridoshan?
That's a good question. He said I was Tridoshan. He didn't break out Prakriti and Prakriti. That's a really good question. Next time I see you. But no, I Hi-pita. In my Vata years. So things are drying out. I mean, my shit was effortless all my life. And now I got a spot in my body, put a stool up. It's not, I mean, it's not regular, but it's not effortless. This is a result of the drying out of the colon. And see, in this intense heat, you can see how that's not good. Like, Chrissy, very kindly brought me something to drink. So I shut up for a while for you. Yeah, that's also my throat. So yeah, that's a possibility. Like air and ether, vata is easily shaped. It's the easiest to shape it. Earth and water, difficult to shape. Fire cleans to things. So you want to shape fire, change where it's coming. Vata is the environment, time, or the season of old age. Vata rules old age, and therefore we must recognize, understand, and balance the increase of vata in our diet and lifestyle to maintain or create balance in our old age. So like too much stress in our old age is really harmful. Whereas a lot of stress in the pitta years can make you stronger. Or you see, but when you get stressed in your old age, then it will weaken you. So vata, one is most susceptible to change. That's why when people teach yoga, restorative yoga is the yoga for older people, not the athletic yoga. I forget the concept. A lot of the yoga teachers are not familiar with Ayurveda, and they're doing very intense yoga exercise. For old people, it's just wrong. It's like giving pittas, you know, tomato salad and tomato juice for lunch. You know, just imbalanced. That doesn't mean Vata doesn't exercise, but it's... I'm out on the Malcolm. It's a 50-mile long. It looks as big as this ocean. And I walk every morning and you see all these old people just walking really fast, you know, and they see me strolling along. And eventually, a couple of them, I wear a Himalayan hat. And eventually they come and they talk to me. But they say, why do you walk so slow? And I said, I'm strolling. And they said, oh, we're exercising. You know, I said, it's fine. I said, but as you get older, it's not about exercise to build up strength. It's restorative. It's a whole different goal. And that is elucidated in the Yoga Sutras, the Hatha Yoga Pradipika. the textbook Hatha. Every single asana is described in dosha terminology. Every single one. The only school I know that teaches that, that I know of, which I'll show this on this day, is the Iyengar, and then only certain of those teachers seem to know. Okay, interestingly, our modern environment is extremely vata, more so than ever time in history. We move faster, we do more, we process our foods, our drinks, use modern medicine to suppress our disease symptoms, spend more time in front of the computer and TV. I'm a writer, I confess to that. Won't rub it in. Movies move faster. You ever seen old movies? There's a long time in one scene and then it's cut to the other scene. Now it's like, boom, 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 boom. This is all increasing vata. Girls get their periods at a younger age. What are the qualities or the gunas of vata according to Ayurveda? Vata is cold, dry, well, I didn't put it in there. Cold, dry, hard, light, irregular, rough, moving, it's the only moving dosha, quick, changeable, sharp. These are the gunas of that dosha. So, what the heck do you do with that? The working principle of Ayurveda is balance. So similars increase one another, opposites decrease one another. So for cold, bring in warm. Okay. Too much
so this
heat.
Environment would be good for vatas.
What's that?
This environment here.
For some vatas, yes. For some vata, because of the heat. But too much heat is what I was about to say. Will aggravate vata. See, it's vata likes in between. Not too, you know, I forget the fairy tale. You know, she wants her tea. Yeah, Goldilocks. Not too hot, not too cold. That's fine. Okay, as opposed to light vata, heavy. It's really good, like a massage for vata. You know, not the kind of light, but they need to be pressed. Heavy. As opposed to dry, oily, and most oils are fantastic. But ghee, best of all. Ghee for everybody here. I have a ghee cup. Okay, irregular. Vata is irregular. It always tends to be irregular. So regularity is really, 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 really important. Vata is rough. When Audrey Hepburn got constipation, her girlfriends told her, eat raw foods. You need roughage. You need your balance. It was exactly the wrong advice. She needs smoothage. When a vata person has constipation, there's different. There's always a vata, pitta, and kapha form of every disease. So an Ayurvedic practitioner is dealing with that form of a dosha, which is all constipation is not vata. Quick. Vata is quick. It's good for them to slow down. Mobile. They're always changing. It's good for them to be steady. And vata is very subtle, so touch is very, very, very good for them and balances them. When vata dosha is out of balance, there's an excess of the qualities that define that dosha. For instance, light, the person loses weight, cold, the person feels chilled, the skin dry, the skin, lips, mucosal glands become dry. Mobile, the voice becomes too quick or rambles. Subtle, the person is easily affected by the feelings of others. Hard, stools become hard, difficult to eliminate. These are just examples. Irregular, they are, so they're easy to change, which can leave them without the ground to stand on. And rough, the skin becomes rough, especially in older people, the skin becomes rough. Look at how vata characteristics are similar to the effects of old age. Good. The kashaya means drawing out. Okay, dhatu. Dhatu is tissues. Dhatu kashaya means generation of tissues. You ever see Arnold Schwarzenegger in his prime? Have you seen recent pictures of him? I mean, he's like drying out. Indriya, that's the senses.
I think Arnold Schwarzenegger
is... What's that?
Arnold Schwarzenegger isn't Vata.
No.
He's just in the Vata period as well.
He's a big Kapha.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Super Kapha, right? In his Vata years. But he overdid it. I mean, here's a like, tremendously strong, vital guy doing exercise almost like eating exactly all the foods. And he had heart surgery. It was a turning point. It was like it started becoming very blocked up after that. But that could have been Bailey. Okay. Degeneration of the senses. And here. Mala Kashaya, loss of strength. Utsaka Kashaya, loss of motivation. Virya Kashaya, decreased libido. Too much spending of the semen, either through intercourse or through masturbation, that loss of semen speeds up aging in male. Vali, increasing wrinkles, palataya, graying of hair, and kali, baldness. And here's several pictures. I just thought, I found this online. A young person is 25, now at 102. Looks pretty healthy. There, everybody ages. You see how the ears get really big?
Yeah, your ears never stop growing, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's crazy.
For years, I thought, in India, whenever you see a statue of the Buddha, it's got huge ears like this. Always. And I was told that it was indicative of a constitution of the person. I mean, I did not research this, but I was told it was indicative of the constitution of the person. This guy's 102 years old, and he looks pretty good. But he's also got big, long beard. Ayurveda offers the knowledge of how to bring Vata dosha into balance. The principle to achieve balance is by increasing the opposite qualities of whatever elements or dosha effects are in predominance presently. Change can be made in everything: daily routine, sleep, sex, diet, herbal supplements, colors, aromas, massage oils, overall lifestyle. Through adopting an appropriate diet and lifestyle, we can bring Vata dosha into balance. Like every other dosha, people who have high Vata have been given a blessing and a curse. Everyone's given a blessing, and the blessing is exactly where the curse is, and vice versa. The blessing for Vata is that it is easy for them to change. The curse for Vata is that it is easy for them to change. Whatever is done must be done regularly. Mata itself tends to be irregular. That's what it is. And irregularity only increases Mata dosha. You see kids staying all night, partying, and this and that. In their pitta years, they're doing that. And that builds up an accumulation of Mata so that they often express disease even in the age. Here's more about what Ayurveda says about Vata dosha. So those with predominance of Vata dosha usually have a thin, light frame and excellent agility. Their energy comes in bursts. They're likely to experience sudden bouts of fatigue. They typically have dry skin and hair, cold hands and feet. They sleep lightly. Their digestion can be sensitive and easily thrown off. When the Vata dosha becomes imbalanced, it manifests in the body as weight loss, constipation, hypertension, arthritis, weakness, restlessness, and digestive challenges. How are we doing for time?
12:22.
Oh, Chrissy says, what? What are you saying? Finish it. Oh. Well, it's been nice knowing you all. You have a great life. So we'll continue. If you want, I just want you to know that the whole presentation is up on my website. And yep, I got it.
You're lose my head.
I'm so narcissistic.
And I'm still hoarse.
Oh, that's why.
I'm so narcissistic.